Good evening, PSJ family. I'm Norma Godson. I'm the Family and Community Engagement Director. I want to thank you for being a part of our virtual Family Learning Academy tonight. It is our vision for every PSJ student to be prepared to participate, compete, and excel in a global society to foster multi-generational prosperity. Today's presentation is going to be, we have a presenter. Her name is Jennifer Espino. She's a prevention specialist. She's actually part of a collaborative partnership, and she is going to do that from, she's from the Behavioral Solutions of South Texas, and she's going to do her topic today, which is improving communication with teens. We're ready, Jennifer. Welcome to our district. We want to welcome our parents tonight, and Jennifer Espino's ready for her presentation. Welcome.
Thank you. Welcome, parents. Thank you so much for joining us. As mentioned, we are going to be talking about family communication. We do have presentation both in English and in Spanish, and I do have access to your comments. So if you have any questions at any point throughout the presentation, feel free to go ahead and type them. And as well, we'll have some time left at the end for any Q&A questions so I can go ahead and answer them. But thank you. My name is Jennifer Espino. I believe our screen is ready to go. So we'll go ahead and get started. I am a prevention specialist here with BHS, Behavioral Health Solutions. And let's get started. A little bit about our agency. We are a nonprofit organization that services all of South Texas. We do service Region 11, which is composed of 19 counties. And we provide prevention, intervention, treatment, recovery, and research services. So we have our own PRC center that provides a lot of data here locally as to teenagers, parents, what it is that they're using, what it is that the needs are needed here in our community. I myself work under prevention, which is just providing any education, information, and any resources to our communities, whether it's parents, schools, teachers, kids, anything that is needed, we do go ahead and provide that for you guys. Schools as well, whether it's presentations, activities, educational sessions. You know, pre-COVID, we used to do a lot of health fairs, but of course now times are different, and I am so glad that all of us have been able to adjust to it. We do have a saying that 1 ounce of prevention is a pound of treatment. So in our end of the prevention side, if we're able to provide 1 ounce, then that is just going to be 1 pound of treatment in the long run, where it's going to prevent people from falling into negative consequences and behaviors, primarily with substance use. Okay, so let's get started. What is still happening? You know, it's almost going to be exactly 1 year since our kids went out for spring break and they never went back to school. Till this day, you know, a lot of our kids are still learning from home. A lot of us as parents are still working from home. And it's been difficult this whole past year just trying to adjust to everything that is going on. So COVID-19, it's a pandemic that affected all of us in all of the aspects that we could possibly think about. Schools were closed down. Now they are limited in capacity as to how many students can go back in. A lot of school districts still don't have their teachers back on campus, of course, because of their safety, but you know, now it's different. Children are at home, parents are at home. They started learning from home. We started working from home, and it was, you know, some rough times to communicate between that and our kids. Education and work, of course, continued from home. Supermarkets didn't have any food. Who remembers this whole toilet paper scenario that we experienced? And, you know, not that long ago when the weather got really bad and it froze, once again, we saw it again. You know, there wasn't food at the supermarkets. Luckily, I was able to find toilet paper this time, but no food. So there was that. So these are difficult times for everybody. Therefore, keeping your calm as a parent is important for your youth. Your youth are going to look up to you. So if you're able to keep calm, that is going to make them feel a little bit better and safer throughout this whole situation. Okay, so little eyes see and little ears listen. Our kids, they're like sponges and they absorb everything that is going on around them. So from the time that they're born up until 5 years, they absorb everything. And then once they turn 13, once they go into the adolescent teenage years, once again, they become like little sponges and start absorbing everything that is going on around them. That is when they're creating their identity, and everything and everyone influences them, especially what they see at home. Therefore, manners, treatments of others, substance use, behavior, and even appearance is going to affect the way that they behave and the way that they grow up. I don't know if a lot of you guys remember when your kids were little, if you as a mom would wear high heels, they would want to wear high heels as well. Or dads, if you would wear ties or a specific jacket to work or to go out, your little boys would want to wear it as well. And that's just because everything that they see coming from us, their parents and adults, they're going to want to try and do it as well. Our behavior and hardship situations influence how our youth are going to handle those situations when they become adults and when they are experiencing them as well. So everything that we do as adults, they're learning as well, and we're actually providing them with tools and skills for them to do, for them to face the same situations that we were facing when they were kids. But of course, now they would be adults facing them. So therefore, that's why communication is key. They can learn everything from us, but if we're not communicating with them why it is that we're behaving such way or why it is that we're doing what we're doing, then they're going to be lost and they're not going to fully comprehend what it is that they're going to have to do when they get older. So when there's communication, the child's self-esteem, trust, and mutual respect from one another is established. Communication is important because it helps us explain the consequences and concerns of substances and any other major life event. For example, this past this current pandemic that we're still going on. They didn't know what was going on. We didn't know what was going on. So therefore, you know, when we learned how school was going to go, how they were going to have to learn from home, if we were able to communicate that with them, then they were going to understand and comprehend better how it is that they needed to behave, how it is that they were going to change and adapt as well with us together to this whole situation that happened. Having children live in a bubble is not the best thing, and it does not protect them for adulthood. I know as a parent, we want to do everything that it is to keep our kids safe, to protect them from everything that can possibly go wrong. But keeping them in a bubble and sheltered is not going to prepare them for different things that happen in adulthood. You know, they're going to think that everything is great and is perfect, and they're protected from a lot of things. And then when they become adults, when they have their own family, they're going to be lost, not knowing how it is to handle different situations. So as much as we want to protect them, it is important for them to learn and for them to know the different adversities that do happen in our, you know, in day-to-day life. So right now, specifically with their youth, these are a couple of things that they are facing that sometimes, you know, as adults, we have our own problems and we can kind of forget or put them in our back mind as to what it is that's going on with them. So currently, they still have stress about school, learning from home. If you have any juniors or seniors, either this year or last year, then, you know, they were looking for towards prom, graduation, all of these different things that you get to do as a senior or that you get to do in high school that they're not currently doing right now because of the pandemic. So that does put a couple of pressure on them. If they were doing sports and, you know, perhaps relying on a sports scholarship, then that's kind of a little bit tricky and confusing right now because, well, are they playing sports? Are coaches scouting? So that just puts stress on the student as well. Anger for not being able to go out and do normal things. Once again, you know, we went from having basketball, football, to everything being cut down completely. I do know some places are open, of course, with their restrictions, but it's not the same thing as it used to be before. So automatically when everything shut down, we were in at a lockdown shelter in place for a whole month, the whole month of April. So that was difficult for them as well. You know, they were used to having a routine, get up, go to school, go to practice or extracurricular activities, go home, homework, and it was a set schedule, and that all of that changed from one day to another. So definitely anger and frustration were probably some feelings that a lot of youth and also as us as parents, we were experiencing. Lost of that social connection. A lot of our kids haven't seen their friends. They haven't had that connection with other people, talking to them. I know one of my coworkers has a 3-year-old daughter, and she says, you know, next year she's going to be 4, and it's been a whole year of COVID. I don't know how she's going to get along with other kids. again, because that social connection hasn't been there anymore. Body image, especially when it comes to social media. Right now, since we're at home, all of these streaming apps became very popular. Netflix, Hulu, TikTok became very popular this pandemic. And there are so many different things that they talk about in all of these apps. So body image can be one of them. Bullying as well. Any cyber conflicts or frustrations that put stress on our kids as well. And also, you know, they get stressed for us too. If they see that we're struggling, especially when they're a little bit older, if they see that we're having a hard time adjusting to situations or just different things that are going on at home, they stress for us as well. So all of these things were going on. And this is not to say that us as parents, we don't have different things to deal with. But for a second, you know, let's just think what it is that kids and youth are going through right now. So what can we do? Now as parents, we know what it is that our kids are facing. We know what we are facing. How can we do to make it a better time at home and to help us and our kids as well? So these are five different communication tips that you can do. You can start practicing. A lot of them, you probably already do them and you don't realize them, that you don't realize that they're skills and that they're tips for you for communication. So these are the five ones. Number one, you are the parent. Number two, communication at an early age. Listen is number three. Number four, think before you assume. And number five, establish a reward and punishment system. So we'll go ahead and go through them individually. So number one, you are the parent. So they do not educate you, you educate them. At the end of the day, the primary source of education is coming from you, your the parents, and from teachers. So yes, they can help us with technology, with the computers, but at the end of the day, if they have questions, if they have concerns, they're going to come to us for answers. Therefore, it's important for us to start the conversation if we see that they're not coming to us. Ask what they know and correct them with facts. Hey, son, daughter, what it is that you know about this topic? For instance, vaping has become very popular. What is it that you know about vaping? And if correct them with facts and with proper information. Facebook is not a news source and much less about COVID or any substance. That personally happened in my home when the whole pandemic started happening. My mom started believing everything that Facebook was saying about the pandemic and how it spread and all of these different things. And it was like, okay, mom, no. I appreciate your enthusiasm for, you know, trying to stay up to date, but just Facebook is not a reliable source. Make sure that you proofread the articles and that the presentations or the articles that you're reading do come from a reliable source. You are their role models. Pre-pandemic, we used to go to schools and have the opportunity to interview students one-to-one. And one of the questions we would always ask was, who is your role model? Like, when you grow up, who do you want to be like? And 95% of the students would always tell me, my mom or my dad or a close family member. But it's always mom or dad. So don't ever forget, you know, you are the role models. Whatever it is that you do is going to impact them. And they look up to you to become good, better adults and better teenagers. The more you're involved, the better. The more you know about them, about their schedule, about their friends' friends, just everything involving their life, the better prepared you're going to be in case of an emergency or in case anything comes up. You're going to know what you need to ask and who it is that you're going to need to look for. Okay, communication at an early age. Pretty straightforward. The earlier you start talking to them, the better communication you're going to have throughout their teenage years. Use education and facts, not scare tactics. A lot of times, especially when our kids are babies and when they're barely understanding, if we don't want for them to touch something, we tell them, no, it's hot, or you're going to get hurt, or the monster's going to come. Something that's going to get them scared for them to not touch that object or for them to not, you know, be banging on the door, whatever the case is. But as they get older, they're going to start noticing and realizing what's true and what's not true. So the more education and the more facts we provide them with, the better knowledge they're going to have in the long run. It takes two to have proper communication. We cannot expect for our kids to come home or just to be open about us with everything that's going on with them if we do not communicate with them as well. It takes two parties to have proper open communication. And not everything is perfect. And it's important that we communicate that with them as well. Once again, let's try not keep them in a bubble where they think that everything is perfect, because sooner or later, they're going to become adults. They're going to face their own problems. And if we provide them with tools and strategies for them to do as adults, they're going to be better off once they're faced with those situations. Communicate what's different. Birthdays are different. You know, we cannot blow on cakes anymore. I cannot believe we used to do that, but we can't blow on our birthday cakes anymore. Parents are also working from home. Everybody started being at home from one day to another. So that was very different. Not going to school now that there's vaccines, maybe next school year, they're going back to school. So just everything that is affecting their life and we know something about, it's important to communicate to them as well. Listening. So we have to listen, not just hear. Really listen to what it is that your kids are saying. Most of the times they just want to vent because they have so many things going on in their life. They're adjusting to so many things, school, sports, friends, if they're already dating, having to do all of these applications and all of this homework for school. So a lot of times they just have a lot of buildup and they want to vent. But during those venting sessions, it is important to focus on their emotions. Okay, why is this making you angry? Why is this making you sad? What is making you happy? Maybe let's try and do a little bit more of that. So focusing on their emotions is going to benefit us as parents, know how we can help them. And don't stay without any kind of doubts. Don't stay with any doubts, I should say. If there's something that's not adding up or you're not 100% sure about, continue asking them. Ask them until you have peace of mind of what is going on with them. Think before you assume. Of course, avoid jumping to conclusions. I grew up with the saying my mom used to always say, dime con quien te juntas y te diré quién eres. So it basically translates to tell me who you're hanging out with and I'll tell you who you are. And, you know, maybe a lot of times it is applicable, but at the same time, just because your kid's friends are doing something doesn't mean that your kid has to be involved in it or supports whatever their friends are doing. So let's try and avoid jumping to conclusions. Always try and let them finish whatever it is that they have to say. Again, that just goes hand in hand with jumping to conclusion. Think of the best way to react without scaring them. A lot of times kids are not completely open to telling us everything that's going on with them because they're afraid of our reaction. They're afraid that we're going to get scary and punish them and we're not going to understand where they're coming from. Let's all remember we were all teenagers once. We were all kids at some point. So, you know, we made our own mistakes and now it's our turn to understand where it is that they're coming from. Of course, if, you know, there needs to be a punishment or if you need to have a talk to them, then you go ahead and do so. But just don't, your initial reaction shouldn't be a scary one because then next time they're going to be hesitant to talk to you about a situation. And let's remember that they do not think like us. They do not think like adults. Human brains do not fully develop until the age of 25. So, you know, they're still not adults. A lot of times we might say, why couldn't you think of the consequences? Well, it's because they don't think the way that we do. Their alert system, like the little red flags that go off in our brain, don't go off in their brain just yet because it's not fully developed. And number five is the reward and punishment system, which is kind of like a little tug of war or like an exchange method. It's you give me and I give you. So, for example, when our kids were little, we would go to the store and we would tell them, okay, if you behave well, I'll buy you a bag of chips or a chocolate bar. So then the whole time that they were at the store, they would behave good. When we would get to the register to check out, hey, mom, dad, can you buy me my chips or my chocolate? I behaved well. Now it's like, well, we have to go through with what we said because that's what we promised. And they did give us good behavior. So that's the reward and punishment system. You have to go through with what you said, whether it is with rewards and punishments. You know, going back to that same example, if we do not buy our kids that bag of chips, the next time our kids are thinking, you know what, last time I behaved really well and my mom still didn't give me what she promised. this time, even if she tells me she's going to buy me a bag of chips, I know she's not going to, so I do not have to behave well. So that trust is already kind of broken. They're not going to believe anything that we say anymore when it comes to their behavior. So it's important that we have to go through with what we said, whether it is a reward or a punishment. Explain the consequences and punishments as well. No, you know what? You're not getting your bag of chips because you did not behave well at the store. You cannot go to your friend's house because you did not get A's and B's as we promised. You cannot watch TV past this time because you didn't finish your homework. Explaining to them the consequences is going to help them understand why they're not getting what was promised to them. A lot of times they don't realize that it was, you know, their own behavior that caused those consequences. Because I say so does not improve the situation. A lot of times, you know, we are parents. We do have the authoritative figure. We are the authoritative figure at the end. So a lot of times we just say, well, because I say so, because I'm the parent. Well, that's not really giving them an explanation as to why the situation changed. Again, we go back to they're not thinking the way we do. And a lot of times they don't fully process or comprehend how the situation changed and why they're not getting the reward that they were promised. And as our kids, our youth grow, your rewards and consequences are going to have to change. Of course, when they were little, they might want a bag of chips at the grocery store. Maybe when they're in middle school, they want to go to a school dance, pre-COVID, of course, or go to their friend's house. Maybe they might want to FaceTime a friend. When they're in high school, they're going to want to start going to football, basketball, soccer games. You know, if they're dating, go out with their friends, go to the movies. So as they get older, their rewards are going to start increasing. And so do their responsibilities should also start increasing as to what it is that you're asking from them. And right now, well, we just have to be creative, especially during this times. You know, their rewards are kind of limited because we cannot go to many places. But this is a great time for us to be creative, to use our parenting skills and anything that our kids are enjoying while they're at home with us. So now, what can you do as parents in order to maintain order at home now that our kids are still learning from home, and you know, they're going to continue doing so until the end of the school year? So maintain a routine as if the kids are still in school. It is difficult to adapt to these changes. If it was difficult for us, more than likely it was difficult for them as well. So keeping a school routine, hey, from this time to this time, you are in school, so you need to focus on school. We're not watching cartoons. You're not being on your phone, which leads to the second point. Limit the time on their phones. In school, they couldn't use their phones. So if they're learning from home during school time, please put your phone away. If they need it for homework, I know that's the case for a lot of students, then that's fine. But if you're just seeing that they're on different social media apps, then that's, you know, that's not benefiting them. Get outside. A lot of places are still closed, but, you know, we can still go outside, take some deep breaths. If you have a front or a backyard, that's, you know, perfect to do so. I know some of the parks are open. Just be mindful as to how many people are in the park or are in the running trail. But, you know, outside, we're finally getting to a good evening temperature. So let's enjoy that as well. Home and school tasks, it is important to go ahead and keep order. So yes, just how our kids have homework to do, then let's continue giving them a home task as well in order to keep our home and their learning space and center, you know, up to date, clean and proper for learning. And lastly, we have to stay calm together. If you're stressed, they're probably stressed. If they're stressed, you're stressed as well. So once again, having that communication, why is it that you're stressed? Okay, well, you know, it's different from me because, well, we just have different responsibilities. But communicating that with our kids, it's what's going to help both of us at the end of the day. But more than anything, we have to take care of ourselves. I know it's hard. I know as parents, it's very normal for us to put our kids first. And I applaud all parents who do so. But we do have to take care of ourselves as well. We cannot help our kids or our youth if we do not feel well with ourselves. If we are overstressed, if we are overworked or just overwhelmed with everything, you know, we're not helping them any if they are coming with a problem and we're not able to help them because we are overwhelmed with our own problems. So therefore, professional help is here to help and not to embarrass. A lot of times, especially in our region, in our culture, it can be deemed as to, well, oh, this person is needing help, but everybody needs help once in a while. Most school districts are still offering their free meals, and they continue to offer a lot of services to parents and to kids as well. I didn't know that tutoring was still going on, but a couple of districts still have tutoring available for kids. The Boys and Girls Clubs as well. The libraries are open. So any additional help that kids needs, is still available. The food bank is still open and our offices are still open as well, which leads me to the next slide. If anybody needs any outpatient treatment services for adults, these are our phone numbers and the people that you can go ahead and contact. Our treatment services, they are completely free of charge. You just have to, you know, go through the assessment process, but this is for adults. If you know of anybody, you can go ahead and take a screenshot of this. And just recently this year, we also started offering treatment services for youth. So this is something new that we, our agency, used to not have before. And it is called Monarch. And again, it is treatment for youth. And you can go ahead and call the number here on this. It's the same flyer in English and in Spanish. If you have any questions or if you would like more information, you can go ahead and contact us. It is for teens that are 13 through 17 years, and they have to be in need of treatment. So go ahead and stay on this slide because this is the last one of our presentation. I don't know if any of you guys, if we have any parents with questions. Let me see here.
I didn't see any questions, Jennifer, but I have a question for you because I think a lot of our parents that are here might be interested in the Monarch. So if I have a teenager and I'm one of the parents right now listening and my teenager is very defiant and I want him help, do I have to be from a certain school district? And what do I need to refer him or so that you all could treat him at the Monarch?
Yes. So this new service, Monarch, it is for any youth who has a substance use treatment or any kind of addiction and is in need of substance use treatment. There we go. So you can just go ahead and call the 956-787-0004, extension 14. And through that phone number, they will be able to tell you specifically if a referral is needed. To my understanding, it is not. That is more like towards the treatment side of our agency. But it's just completing an assessment with kids, with the youth, kind of knowing what services or what treatment plan would be most helpful for them. And then from there, you know, we go ahead and take it on. If it is any... let's say if it doesn't qualify for this treatment specifically because it doesn't fall under a substance use, you can still go ahead and call. And our services also provide referrals and additional resources. So if this specific program is not right for you, then we'll go ahead and find another program, whether it's within our agency or in another agency, wherever it is closest to you, then we do provide that information for parents as well.
Is there a charge for the service or no? Or do they?
No, not for this one.
Everything is free.
No, all of our services are completely free since we are a nonprofit organization. Yes.
Okay, parents, that's really good to know. Any child that you have, substance use, abuser that needs treatment, that's a phone number to call and it's everything free, 13 to 17 years old. Thank you, Jennifer Espino, and thank you, audience, parents, and our parent educators that are here with us today. Parents, we gave you on our parental page the registration page. You can just register with your child's name, and we ask you, like, what are some of the presentations you want to see? But we thank you for being here tonight, and join us. It's already 6:30. We're going to go on and have our session in Spanish. Good night. Have a great evening, parents.